Hello, we welcome you to this Bible study of the Banking Blessings Ministry. Today we are going to look at Christ's advice to us, Christ's charge to us that we minister by deed. And that if we minister by deed, in other words, if we do things, if we convey the message of the gospel through our actions, through the things we do, then people will be drawn to us. And we notice that this is the way people were drawn to him during his ministry. Of course, he was preaching, but he was doing miraculous things. He was healing the sick. He was casting out demons. And of course, he was compassionate in everything he did. He showed kindness to people. He was attentive to the needs of people, and he paid attention and tried to do what he could to help the people. And this is really what drew people to him, his actions, his deeds, the things he did. So we are going to look at this a little more carefully tonight to understand why his deeds drew people to him. Of course, we know people wanted to be healed and all that. They want to understand this in a way that enables us to see why he said that we can also draw people to God through our deeds. We will learn that people were drawn to Jesus by his deed, by his compassion, by his healing of the sick, and expelling evil spirits. He did this everywhere he went, and people came to him in large, unbelievable large numbers because of these actions, because of what they expected to benefit. And of course, they had his words during the process. They listened to his message, and he teaches us that we can do the same. In other words, that we can minister to people through our deeds, and that our deeds will draw people to us in the same way that his deeds drew people to him. We are going to study this, taking examples from the gospel according to Matthew, Mark, and Luke. We know that Jesus, during his ministry, he spent a lot of time in Galilee, and he went about in the area, went to synagogues and taught in the synagogues. He healed every disease and every sickness that he encountered, everything that he saw. Whichever person he saw that was sick or that was afflicted with any kind of disease, he healed that disease. And because of this, people brought the sick to him. People came to him in large numbers. They brought people that were demon possessed, and they came from all around. Let us read about this in the three gospels, Matthew chapter 4 verses 23 to 25, Mark 3 verse 7 to 11, and Luke 4 verses 40 to 41.
Matthew, verse 23. Jesus went throughout Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and healing every disease and sickness among the people. News about him spread all over Syria, and people brought to him all who were ill with various diseases, those suffering severe pain, the demon-possessed, those having seizures, and the paralyzed, and he healed them. Large crowds from Galilee, the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, and the region across the Jordan followed him.
Okay, now from Mark chapter 3.
Mark chapter 3, verse 7. Jesus withdrew with his disciples to the lake, and a large crowd from Galilee followed. When they heard about all he was doing, many people came to him from Judea, Jerusalem, Idumea, and the regions across the Jordan and around Tyre and Sidon.
Yeah, notice here that Mark made it very clear. He said, when they heard about all he was doing, many people came to him, trying to emphasize that people came to him because they heard that they could get healed, that their loved ones could get healed, their loved ones that were possessed by demon could be free from the demon. This was what brought them to him. And of course, when they came to him, they had the gospel. And of course, they got their people healed. Let's continue with the reading from Mark 3,
verse 9. Because of the crowd, he told his disciples to have a small boat ready for him, to keep the people from crowding him. For he had healed many, so that those with diseases were pushing forward to touch him. Whenever the impure spirits saw him, they fell down before him and cried out, "You are the Son of God."
Now from Luke, go ahead.
Luke chapter 4, verse 40. At sunset, the people brought to Jesus all who had various kinds of sicknesses, and laying his hands on each of them, on each one, he healed them. Moreover, demons came out of many people, shouting, "You are the Son of God." But he rebuked them and would not allow them to speak, because they knew he was the Messiah.
Okay, so we saw this, the three Gospels. We didn't take anything from John. I'm sure John has something to the same effect. The three Gospels reported that people came to him because they saw, they heard that he healed the sick. They heard that he cast out demons. They heard that he was very compassionate. So any kind of problem they had, they brought to him. So it was his deeds, it was his actions that drew people to him. Let us look at a specific example. This is about the man with leprosy. The man knelt before him, you know, they were in one of the locations where he was ministering to them. This man knelt before him and said that he was sure that if Christ was willing, that if Jesus was willing to heal him, that he will make him clean. So Jesus extended his hand and touched the man, and he said, "Of course, I am willing." And of course, he made the man clean. Then he told him something very important. He said, "Go and report yourself to the priest." Essentially, go and check in with the priest and perform the sacrifice that Moses directed that you perform. In other words, in order to be accepted back into the society, because those with leprosy were cast away, they were not allowed to rejoin the society. So in order to be accepted back into the society, there is a rite you need to perform, there is a custom you need to fulfill. So he advised, after the healing, the man said, "Yes, I have healed you, but my healing is not enough. You need to go and satisfy this custom of the people." So he showed how much he cared for the people he healed. It's not just that he healed them, but the way he talked to them, the way he related to them, showed that he cared about them. And it is this compassion is one of the things that made people very comfortable around him. Let us read about this in Matthew chapter 8, verses 1 through 4.
When Jesus came down from the mountainside, large crowds followed him. A man with leprosy came and knelt before him and said, "Lord, if you are willing, you can make me clean." Jesus reached out his hand and touched the man. "I am willing," he said. "Be clean." Immediately he was cleansed of his leprosy. Then Jesus said to him, "See that you do not tell anyone, but go, show yourself to the priest, and offer the gifts Moses commanded as a testimony to them."
Well, let us try to look at all of these, because there are so many examples that we can't really read about all of them. We are just going to talk about a few and then read the last one. But in all of this, what we see is that the common theme is that people were drawn to him because of his compassion and because of the power of miracles that he showed. The power to do miracles, the power to heal, the power to cast out demons. People saw these things and they were drawn to him in large numbers because of this. And each time they came, of course, they brought problems. Some people came to hear him, no doubt, but a lot of people went to him with problems for him to solve. We remember the case of the centurion. Centurion was a commander in the Roman army, but he went to Jesus and said, "Look, my servant is lying at home, he's in pain. Please, you know, just say the word and you can heal him." Jesus actually offered to go to his home. He said, "No, don't come. I know that if you say the word, right here and now, he will be healed." And Jesus was amazed at his faith, and he told the people around him, his disciples, I said, "I haven't seen a faith like this in Israel." And of course, he healed the centurion's servant from there. Then there was the case of Peter's mother-in-law. He went to Peter's house and saw the mother-in-law lying there with a fever. He didn't say, "Well, it's just a simple fever." No, he touched her and the fever left her. Then she got up and started attending to them. Then there was the case of the two demon-possessed men. Men that I think they were said to be living in the cemetery, you know, they living among the graves and all that, and they were so powerful, nobody could touch them, nobody could come to chain them. Whatever chain they put on them, they tore it off. So Jesus, when he met them, the demons inside of them kind of negotiated with him, and he commanded them to join a pack of pigs, and then the pigs ran down into the lake and they all drowned. Of course, the men were freed from their affliction. This is, you know, the Bible passages are given here in the PowerPoint presentation, but we're not going to read them. Like this one is Matthew 8, 28 to 34. It's also discussed in Mark and in Luke, but we're not going to read it. The other example, actually during the last Bible study, we talked about the paralyzed man that were brought by his friends. They brought him, and Jesus, this is the one where they couldn't go in, so they had to climb the roof, make a hole through the roof, and lower their friend to Jesus. And when he saw their faith, he forgave the man his sins and healed him because of the faith of the people that brought him. Well, we know about a ruler that came and reported that his daughter was dead. And he said, "I know that if you come, you can bring her back to life." He followed the man to his house and brought his daughter back to life. Then in the same passage, they talked about a woman that had a long-term bleeding, had been bleeding for more than 12 years. And he just went and touched Jesus' garment, and she was healed. Then there is this case about two blind men. We are going to read that. That's the last example we're given. These are not the only cases. These are just a few examples that we picked to illustrate that a large number of people were drawn to him because they needed him to do something for them, to heal them, to cast out demons. Of course, the demon possessed were brought most of the time. And because of his compassion, the fact that they knew he would pay attention to their problem. The case of the two blind men, they were following him and appealing to him and says, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on us." Then he turned around and touched them, and they were healed. Let us read about this in Matthew chapter 9, verses 27 to 31.
As Jesus went on from there, two blind men followed him, calling out, "Have mercy on us, Son of David." When he had gone indoors, the blind men came to him, and he asked them, "Do you believe that I am able to do this?" "Yes, Lord," they replied. Then he touched their eyes and said, "According to your faith, let it be done to you." And their sight was restored. Jesus warned them sternly, "See that no one knows about this." But they went out and spread the news about him all over the region.
Yeah, they went out and spread the news all over the region. The reason they went to him was to regain their sight, and they regained their sight. So they went out to tell people, even though he told them not to, that they shouldn't spread it, but they did. Well, so why were people drawn to him? That's most like a question with an obvious answer. They were drawn to him because they expected healing, they expected something from him. But I think there is another answer. What it is that his compassion and his power of healing, the fact that he could cast out demons, the fact that he could heal people, these are all manifestations of his godliness. He is God. But how this showed, how the fact that he is God, the fact that he has the power of God, how he showed in him is that he was able to do these things. The reason this is important is that we people also have a way to be godly. Of course, our godliness will be manifested in a different way, not necessarily through miracles. So the miracles, the power of healing, the power of casting away demons, his compassion, we are all a manifestation of his godliness. So in that case, we can say that what drew people to him was his godliness. People were drawn to him because he was God, because he was godly, and his godliness was manifested in these things that we mentioned. It's important because he taught, for example, in the Sermon on the Mount, he told us that our godliness will draw people to us. And he told us what godliness means, what living in the image of God, what it means. Well, what is human godliness? How does it show? It basically manifests in what we may call, generally, we call it human goodness. That is, every person is a conveyor of God's image. That is, you do things, when people interact with you, the way you relate to them, the things you do with them, we'll go through more in more detail. Make an impact on them that makes them feel God, that makes them feel that God is working on them through you. Then, of course, every person is created to be a channel for God's compassion. Being a channel for God's compassion means being God's provider assistant. When there is a need, God will place that need or place somebody in position to attend to that need. The Good Samaritan is a favorite example. So if there is a need, being a channel for God's compassion means that if a need is placed in your path, that you will not only recognize the need, but you will commit to doing what you can to provide for that need, to help provide for the need. So if a person is a conveyor of God's image, the way we have discussed in several Bible studies, and a channel for God's compassion, then the way you interact with people will draw people to you. And this is what Christ taught in the Sermon on the Mount. He said, let's look at that. A very good example is from Luke chapter 8, verse 16. Let's read it here.
No one lights a lamp and hides it in a clay jar or puts it under a bed. Instead, they put it on a stand so that those who come in can see the light.
Yes, so that those who come in can see the light. Essentially, he's saying, let your goodness be a light that shines to other people. Let the fact that you live in the image of God be a light, a beacon that shines to other people. And what do people do when they see light? They are attracted towards the light, or the light shows them where they are going. You know, like a lighthouse for sheep in the high sea, they follow the light. So let your goodness shine, let your godliness shine. If shining means when you interact with people, the way they feel about you is that there is something special, that God is working for them through you. And when if your interaction with people makes them feel that way, you find that they will be drawn to you. We have examples from the Bible. Remember the story of Joseph, which we told in several Bible studies. Joseph, in Potiphar's house, Potiphar made him in charge of the entire household because he was drawn to Joseph, because something about Joseph told him that God was with him, and that whatever Moses touched prospered. And whatever problem came his way, he did something about it. When he was put in jail, unfortunately also by Potiphar, what happened? The warden, the person in charge of the jail, saw him the same way. He made the same impact. His behavior made the same impact on this warden. And what happened? They placed him in charge of all the prisoners. So you see how somebody's behavior, somebody living in the image of God, draws people. People are drawn to him. People were drawn to him because he lived in the image of God. And that's why they said that God was with him. So manifestations, what are the manifestations of human goodness or human godliness? Well, people see you as dependable and friendly. Make yourself dependable and friendly to people. These are manifestations of godliness. Of course, these are not things you can fake. I mean, we are not saying go and learn how to do this. No, it is your feeling, your heart, the way you feel about people. If you remember the various things that Christ taught in the Beatitudes, which we went through in a previous Bible study. You know, he said, for example, if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, if your desire is to be good to people, if your desire is to convey the image, to represent God in your interactions with people, then he says this desire will be filled, and not only that, you'll be blessed in the process. So these are the things those are the manifestations of human godliness, you know, being dependable and friendly, being a peacemaker. When there is a problem, you look for a way to make peace. You don't try to escalate the problem, you look for a way to make peace. Being compassionate means you are sensitive to needs. You recognize the needs around you and you recognize what you can do and commit to doing what you can do to help provide for the needs because you feel for the person that has this need. That is what compassion is. We've come across it in a few Bible studies. People get the impression that you are truthful, that is, you are telling them the best you know. If the statements you make reflect you are through understanding of the circumstances at the time. You're not trying to make things up to make people feel in a certain way. So if you are truthful, that is a manifestation of godliness. Respect for authority and respect for other people is a manifestation of godliness. Humility, you're humble towards other people, is a manifestation of godliness. And there are several examples. Remember Paul's letter to the Galatians, chapter 5, verse 22, I think, 22 and 23, where he talked about the fruits of the Spirit. We're not going to read it. But those are the manifestations of human godliness. And if this is your behavior, if this is your attitude, if this defines your attitude to people, then people will be drawn to you the same way that they were drawn to Christ. Because what drew them to Christ was his godliness, which of course manifested through miracles. And he told us that the same godliness will draw people to us. Because our godliness is not necessarily manifested through miracles. Some people can perform miracles, but that's not what the expectation. The expectation is through these aspects of human interaction, positive human interaction that conveys the image of God. So when you live that way, then your behavior will draw people to you. So what did we learn? People were drawn to Jesus because of his godliness. And his godliness manifested through compassion and his power of miracles. Similarly, people will be drawn to a person because of the person's godliness. And the godliness of a human being manifests through human goodness or living in the image of God. We can call it human goodness, but what it is conveying the image of God in all your interactions with other people. It's the same godliness. The godliness that drew people to Christ will draw people to you. This actually brings us to the end of today's Bible study. We thank you for participating with us. We pray that you have learned something that will make a positive impact on your life, that will help you draw people towards you because of you are living in the image of God. And most important, draw you closer to God's purpose for your life. Thank you for participating. God bless you.
God bless you.